بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. The Meccan life of Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم. See, he was. We talked about last week about Rasulullah was part of rebuilding of the Kaaba, and after the rebuilding of the Kaaba, when he was about 35 years old, we find that between that time, about 3 years prior to he was appointed as a prophet, he started spending some time in privacy. Of his own, doing some meditation, and he used to go to one of the caves, which is called Ghar Hira. It was on Jabal al-Nur, the mountain of Nur. It's a very small cave where Rasulullah SAW used to go and meditate. He used to take some food supply that includes sawiq. Sawiq is one of the kind of a, you can call it porridge or cereal with wheat and water and dates. These kind of a things he used to take with him, and he used to isolate himself and think about in general about life and creation and these kind of things. And he did not know how to worship Allah Azza wa Jal at this point until he was appointed as a prophet. But we are aware of him that he never worshipped any kind of idols. Now, before I go into more detail of how the first wahi came to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, there is one aspect I would like to share, and inshallah we'll keep this in mind. Then when we are looking into the life of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the Meccan life now, what is the importance of that? As we discussed the importance of prior to Rasulullah became prophet to understand the reality of the society, now the Meccan life is important to understand so we can learn how to transform, how to change, or how he changed, number one, the ignorant society or Jahili society into Islamic society. And the reason it is very important today for us to understand is because we are living in the similar circumstances. When it comes to people who are Muslims, yes, there are Muslims out there. But when it comes to implementation of Islamic way of life or Islamic system on the people, that does not exist. So this is why the Meccan life is important to understand and to look at from the perspective that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam approached the society. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, for example, in three different places, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَالَّذِي أَرْسَلَ رَسُولَهُ بِالْهُدَى وَدِينِ الْحَقِّ لِيُظْهِرَهُ عَلَى الدِّينِ كُلِّهِ. وَلَوْ كَرِهَ الْمُشْرِكُونَ. Other places, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَكَفَ بِاللَّهِ شَهِيدًا. And the meaning of this ayah is, he has sent Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with guidance and religion of truth to, so this deen, this way of life, Islam, become will prevail over all other ways of life. Even though the mushrikun, polytheists, or the kuffar, they will detest it. They will not like it that the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala prevails. But that's the mission Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sent with. See, the reason I am stressing this point is, we see, read the seerah, and if we don't know what was the purpose of him coming to this world, that we may miss the target, and we may not know what we are supposed to learn from the seerah and how to use this seerah for to move forward with it. It is as if, think of this way, that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam did many things in his life. We know that he was a father, he was a husband, and he was a judge, he was the Amirul Jihad, he was the head of the state, and he lived with the non-Muslims, the kuffar, and he lived with the Muslims. And we can see his relationship with all those people, and we can see his akhlaq. We understand how he interacted with the people. But now, at the same time, we have to know what was the mission he sent with, and what was he working towards. And for that, it is important for us to keep this mission statement in our mind all the time when we talk about the life of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And it's because now the very same mission has been assigned to us as an ummah. We know there will be no more prophet after Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and that work of prophets have been passed on to the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So this is our job now to take care of the very same mission, inshallah. So this is true that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, there are many ahadith, for example, that discuss the subject of Rasulullah came for perfection of, for example, the akhlaq. like Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, one of the hadith mentioned by Imam Malik, says, that I was sent to perfect good character. And another hadith, the wording instead of husn al-akhlaq, it's used by salih al-akhlaq. This is reported by Imam Bukhari in his Adab al-Mufrad. And there are other hadith talks about akhlaq as well. And this is true, that we have to make sure our akhlaq are of the best kind, and we try our best to be to go towards a perfection even in akhlaq, and not only akhlaq, even other things also. Similarly, the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam that says ad-dinu mu'amalat, that deen is al-mu'amalat, is mu'amalat. Mu'amalat means the transactions that you undertake with other people, how you deal with the people. So we don't say that the deen is only mu'amalat, or we don't say that deen is only akhlaq. Rather, these are all parts, they are all parts of Islam. This is one way of expressing the importance of certain things in Islam. So akhlaq has a high importance in Islam, and we have to make sure. But this is individual dealings. Similarly, mu'amalat has a lot of importance, and that has to be taken care of according to the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There's another hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam that says, al-hajju arafah, meaning the hajj is arafah. Now, we know that when somebody, the hadith says, hajj is arafah, does not mean the hajj is only arafah, because there are other manasik al-hajj, meaning the other actions that are supposed to be undertaken in the hajj as well. But arafah is one of the most important aspects of hajj. So this is just showing the importance of it. Similarly, the hadith that's talking about husn al-akhlaq or salih al-akhlaq, those hadith are talking about the importance of it. So sometimes what happens is, this is part of Arabic language, that you point towards one the most important juz or the part of an action that could mean it would automatically mean the whole of it, but does not mean that that's all it is. There are other parts within that as well. So similarly, Islam is not limited to akhlaq, or Islam is not limited to mu'amalat either. Islam is a comprehensive way of life. So we have to have all of it. As a matter of fact, if you remember, when we were discussing the people, the Arab of Rasulullah's time, prior to Rasulullah became a prophet, one of some of the good characteristics of those Arab was actually the akhlaq. When it comes to their honesty, when it comes to their fulfilling the promises, or taking care of, let's say, even their tribal people, sometimes they were going to an extreme of doing the dhulm on the others. But they are taking care of the guests. These are some good characteristics they already had prior to Islam, actually. And Rasulullah ﷺ was referred as al-sadiq wal-ameen. So they looked up to these characteristics of being truthful, being honest, as something good. And so Rasulullah ﷺ did not just come for this. So we have to make sure to remember that there's a mission he came with. So Makkan life has to be studied from this point of view, that he came to make sure the deen of Allah Azza wa Jal prevails over all other ways of life. Think of an example, and I gave an example before that in previous sessions when we talked about, like for example, if somebody is building a house, you hire a contractor, he comes and build a house, and he brings doors, he brings walls, and he does all those things to build the house. Now, while he's building the house, it could take 2 months, 3 months, 4 months. He actually still has his own life. He goes back to his family. He has a wife, he has children, or his kids are going to school. He's taking care of them. He goes and does the grocery. He does all the other life affairs as well. But when you talk about building the house, how he built the house, you have to know what he did to build the house. You would not care much about what school his kids were going to, or what kind of what color clothing he was wearing, or what kind of a food he liked to eat. Even though those things are necessary for him to survive. Okay, so similarly, when we obviously Rasulullah's life is more than that. He was an example for us for all the actions. But what I meant by that is, so we have to know that how he fulfilled his mission. And while he was fulfilling the mission, he was doing other things as well. He had a wife or wives later on, and he had children, and he was taking care of the family affairs, his people around him, whether he was the ruler in Medina or not, whether he was in Mecca. So he was taking care of all those things. He was taking care of his business, and we have to know how he was taking care of his businesses as well. But when it comes to the specific action about around his mission, we have to know what actions he undertook. So we'll inshallah talk about all, but we will stress on that aspect as well, inshallah. Because we have to remember, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, whenever he gives us a hukum shari, he gives us a method of how to do it. As we know, al-hukm shari huwa khitabu shari al-mutalliq bi af'al al-ibad. That hukum shari, which is about our actions, it is an address of the shari'. Shari' means Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the legislator, regarding about our actions. So all our actions that we undertake, they have to have a hukum shari' how to do it. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَوَرَبِّكَ لَنَسْأَلَنَّهُمْ أَجْمَعِينَ عَمَّا كَانُوا يَعْمَلُونَ. So your Lord Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, by your Lord, we shall certainly call all of them to account about what they used to do. Meaning, any action that the people were doing, they will be held accountable. If we are accountable for every action that we are undertaking, then it means we have to be given a ruling regarding what is right and wrong from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is why for every action we undertake, we have to know how to do that. Similarly, when we talk about the mission of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we have to know how he fulfilled that mission. Now, going back to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the first time he got the message from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, after setting up this framework, so we'll keep this in mind inshallah when we are learning about the Meccan life of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So as I mentioned, prior to he became a prophet at the age of 40, for about 3 years he used to go to Ghar Hira, and he used to spend time in privacy, in isolation, and that went on for about 3 years. And then a little before, I think about 6 months or so prior to he got the first revelation, he used to see a dream. And when he see a dream, and he will, the next morning, whatever dream he would see, that will come up as a reality, that would happen. Whatever he sees would happen. This went on for some period of time. And then when he was about 40 years old, and he was in Ghar Hira, Angel Jibreel came to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And there are many hadith on this subject about how he came and what he said. So what Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentions, this hadith is reported by Imam Bukhari. It talks about that he was in Ghar Hira, and he says, فَجَاءَ الْمَلَكُ فَقَالَ اِقْرَى. A malak, an angel, which is Angel Jibreel, he came and he said, اِقْرَى, that read. قَالَ مَا أَنَا بِقَارِي. He said, I am not literate. I don't know how to read. And the hadith goes on that then Jibreel, he actually squeezed him. He held him. And then he left it again. And again he said, اِقْرَى. And again Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم said, مَا أَنَا بِقَارِي, that I am not lettered, or I'm not literate. And they did the second time. And third time, after he did the third time, and he said, اقرأ باسم ربك الذي خلق, خلق الإنسان من علق, اقرأ وربك الأكرم الذي علم بالقلم, علم الإنسان ما لم يعلم. So these five ayat, the first five ayat was revealed to Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم. And then third time when he squeezed and left him, Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم recited after him. Now, after that, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, for him it was a very strange experience. And he went back to his wife Khadija, and he was saying that he fears that something may happen to him. He said, I fear that something may happen to me. And Khadija's reply, as we discussed it last week about the characteristics of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that she replied him and comforted him by the kind of characteristic Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam had. She said, never by Allah, Allah will never disgrace you. You keep good relations with your kith and kin, help the poor and destitute, and serve your guests generously, and assist the deserving calamity afflicted ones. So she reminded him of the kind of a person he is, and Allah will not disgrace him. And then Khadija took Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam to her cousin Waraqah bin Nawfal, and Waraqah bin Nawfal was he was the cousin of Khadija. And he already left idol worshipping, and he became a Christian. And not only a regular Christian, rather he was a knowledgeable person, an alim of Christianity. He used to write Injil. Some of the reports talk about that he used to translate from Abrani to Arabic, and others said that he used to write in Abrani or Hebrew. Either way, it's the same thing, because if he is able to translate, he has to read Abrani. And if he's writing from Abrani to Abrani, that's the same thing. So he was one of the people who used to write Injil as well. So when, and this is the reason Khadija took Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam to Waraqah, because Waraqah bin Nawfal was aware of, he was one of the people of the books, and he was aware of these kind of revelations and stuff like that. So when Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam went to him, and Khadija actually introduced like this, she called him as Ibn Ammi, which is the son of my uncle. Listen to your nephew. So she referred to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam as the nephew of Waraqah. The reason is because Waraqah was also from the same lineage which Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was. It goes back to Qusay, and from Qusay it divides into different clans. But from that perspective, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam could be seen as his nephew, even though he was Waraqah was the cousin of Khadija. And also the other Mufassirin say that because he was an old person, and in Arab culture in general, with an older person when you meet, you call him as an uncle. So for Rasulullah's age perspective, he was his uncle. So she said, listen to your nephew. He goes, what have you seen? So Rasulullah described what happened to him. And Waraqah said, this is the same one who keeps the secrets. He called them the Namus, or the angel Jibreel, who used to come to Moses. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent to Moses. And his response was, I wish I were young and could give up the time when you are poor, when your people would turn you out, or they will make you leave your land. And Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was surprised by that. And he said, will they drive me out? And Waraqah replied in the affirmation, and said, any man who came with something similar to what you have brought was treated with hostility. And if I should remain alive till the day when you will return out, then or have to leave, then I would support you strongly. But the hadith goes on that mentions that Waraqah did not live too long after that. After a few days, he passed away. And for a few days, actually, the continuity of the revelation was stopped, and the hadith reported in Bukhari actually discusses about that pause in the revelation, as he used to the hadith. This is the same hadith that Aisha was reporting that talks about that, and after it mentions that Waraqah died after a few days, that the revelation was paused for a while. Some of the mu'rikhin, they go that it was a longer period of time, but the one that seems more correct is that was only for a few days, it was paused. But Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as Imam Bukhari reports the hadith from Aisha, that says that Rasulullah got a little bit afraid of what's going on, and he intended several times to throw himself from the top of his high mountains. And every time he went up the top of the mountain in order to throw himself down, Jibreel would appear before him and say, "Oh Muhammad." He would say, "Oh Muhammad, Ya Muhammad, innaka Rasulullah haqqa," that you are for sure, you are the true messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in truth. So you are a messenger in truth. So whereupon his heart would become quiet and he would calm down and would return home. And whenever the period of coming of the inspiration used to become long, he would do as before. But when he used to reach the top of the mountain, Jibreel would come and remind him of that he is a true messenger. And one of the times when he came to Rasulullah, when he came back home, he actually told this, he started saying, because he was afraid, he started saying, "Zamiluni, zamiluni," that cover me, cover me. And then he was covered. And because of that, one of the surahs of the Quran, Surah Al-Mudathir, that was revealed, that said, "Ya ayyuhal mudathir, qum fa'andhir, wa rabbaka fakabbir, wa thiyabaka fatahir, wa rujza fahjur. وَلَا تَمْنُنْ تَسْتَكْثِرُ وَلِرَبِّكَ فَصْبِرُ." That means that, O you, cover himself, arise and warn. So now Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is ordered. It's not just that you are giving this message. قُمْ فَأَنْذِرْ. Now you get up and you have to warn the other. And while you're warning, وَرَبِّكَ فَكَبِّرُ, you have to glorify your Lord. Meaning, the Rabb Allah Azza wa Jal is bigger than everything else. Meaning, this is what we're talking about, that he is the one that has to be worshipped. He is the one, when we say worship, it means he is the one that from whom we take our halal and haram and the ibadat and mu'amalat and anything we talk about has to go back to this Rabb, and this Rabb is the one. He is going to tell us what to do and what not to do. And keep your clothes clean. And do not confer favor to acquire more. But for your Lord, be patient. See, وَلَرَبِّكَ فَصْبِرْ, that you continue to stick, be patient by your Lord. Meaning, you continue to do what Allah has commanded you, no matter how difficult situation that you are getting into. Now, as we just saw, that when it came to Waraqa bin Nawfal, right after the first revelation, it was disclosed to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam what could be the consequences of this message. And it's not that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not know. Later on, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala actually what made it very clear to him. As one of the incidents that happened when Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, one time he was going towards Kaaba, and there was a person, he was going towards Kaaba, and he was with a child and a woman. So he went there, he started praying. While he was praying, a child came behind and stood next to him, and a woman came and she stood behind them, and they started doing certain actions, which was they were doing the salah. Now, while they were doing that, one of the Sahaba, who was not a Muslim at that time, Afif radiallahu an, and this person, Afif, he came from outside of the Mecca, as it is reported by Imam Tabri, and he was talking to Abbas radiallahu an, who was also not a Muslim at that time. And he saw Rasulullah and the child and the woman doing the actions, and he asked Abbas, who are these people? And he pointed towards Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he said, "This is my nephew, and he says he is the messenger of Allah." And the woman is his wife, and the child is my other nephew or his cousin, Ali radiallahu an. And he said that these are the only three people who are on this religion that he is calling for, and Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam that he's calling, that he is a messenger of Allah. Now, and not only that, he also says that one day the treasures of the Qaisar and the Kisra, which is the Romans and the Persians, will be under his feet, will be under his control. That shows that there were only three people who were Muslims, and Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam's message was, even though this message was not going openly yet, but the people who were around him, they were aware of the message, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he ordered him to take the message to the people around him in the beginning. And while he was calling for this message, this, he was clear about that, that this message is not only to call people to just worship in a certain manner, meaning just do your prayers or just to fast or do the charity work and Hajj. It's not just for the pillars of Islam. Rather, it is a way of life that is going to expand to an extent that the Romans and Persians will be under him. And as we discussed in the previous sessions, that Romans and Persians were two superpowers of that time, and the Arabian Peninsula, Jaziratul Arab, these people were, in reality, compared to them, were nobody. And one of the reports talk about when even Alexander, when he was passing by these Arabs, he looked at them as, these people, there's a barren land, there's nothing to there, and they fight with each other, and he did not even try to take over the land or anything, and he passed by. This is the situation of the Arabian, the Jaziratul Arab was. But even in that situation, when he had only three, including himself, followers, the message in his mind was clear that he is here to carry this message to the whole world. And not only the world, but it will be under the rule of the Muslims. And we'll see that later on, that it was a very quick, small period of time that Muslims were able to achieve these goals. So when Afif heard this from Abbas, and actually Imam Tabari, when he is discussing this incident, he is discussing it from an angle. Because he was actually counting that who came into the folds of Islam first. And he was trying to show that these were the only three people who were Muslim at that time. And Afif, later on, he actually felt bad, and he wished that he would have accepted Islam that day, and he would have been the fourth person to enter into four folds of Islam. But unfortunately, it took him a longer time to enter into folds of Islam, probably another, I believe, about 15 or 20 years after that he entered into folds of Islam. But he had the opportunity, he did not avail at that time, and this is what he felt bad about later in his life. Now, the first people who entered into the folds of Islam, when we look at the seerah, what we find is Khadija was the first one who entered into folds of Islam right away. And she did not, and then the second person was, some people say Abu Bakr, some say Ali, but in general, the way that they, if you want to call it, break the tie, it is mentioned in the books of the Seerah like this. The first woman who entered into folds of Islam was Khadija. First child who entered into folds of Islam was Ali. First free man who entered into folds of Islam was Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anhu. And the first slave who entered into folds of Islam was Zayd bin Harith. So these are the first ones who entered into folds of Islam. Now, besides them, there were few of the people who entered into folds of Islam because of Abu Bakr Siddiq. His connections. He was a well-known person within Mecca, and influential person, influential in a sense of not only because of the power or something, but rather because of his personality as well. He was a well-respected person among the Meccans, and the people who entered into folds of Islam, they were later on, they became one of the big Sahabas, like Uthman bin Affan radiallahu anh, Zubair bin Awam also came into Islam because of Abu Bakr, Abdurrahman bin Auf, Sa'ad bin Abi Waqas, Az-Zuhri, Talha bin Ubaidullah. Now, if you look at these people, among them, besides Abu Bakr himself, Uthman, Abdurrahman bin Auf, Talha bin Ubaidullah, Sa'ad bin Abi Waqas, and Zubayr ibn Awam, all of them were the ones from the people who were given the glad tiding to enter into the Jannah in the dunya. And they were among these eight men constituted the forerunners, and more specifically the vanguard of Islam in Arabia. We see that in the later seerah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And besides that, there were people like Bilal bin Rabah. He was also he was a slave. And when Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu an, he saw Bilal was getting tortured by his master Umayyah bin Khalaf, he freed him. And similarly, people like Abu Ubaidah bin Jarrah also was came into Islam through Abu Bakr. Abu Salama, Al-Arqam bin Arqam, who was the one that we will see that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam he used his house as a place to gather the Sahaba who entered into folds of Islam, and he used to teach them over there. Uthman bin Ma'zun and his two brothers Qudama and Ubaidah, both of them came into folds of Islam through him, and many more. So Abu Bakr Siddiq, he was one of those people. If you read his biography, his seerah, we'll find that the kind of things that he did in his life, and we understand that why Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam referred to Abu Bakr as, if you put the iman of all the ummah on one side and the iman of Abu Bakr on the other, Abu Bakr will outweigh them. And things like that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said about Abu Bakr. It is because of his actions that he undertook. As we know, if all these people, he came into the folds of Islam through Abu Bakr, we know the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam that talks about, if you bring one person into the folds of Islam, and the good deeds that he does, the one through whom he have entered into folds of Islam, he will continue to get the hasanat. So he had so many of them, even the ones who are already given the glad tiding of Jannah came into the folds of Islam through him. That shows that the level of Abu Bakr in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But anyways, that's about Abu Bakr, and inshallah we'll talk some other time in more detail about his life as well. But so these are the people who in general, in the beginning of Islam, they enter into folds of Islam. And there's a ikhtilaf about this issue of whether the salah was, how much of the salah was made. Salah was there, but whether it was obligatory or not until the Isra wal Mi'raj. And the reports that talk about is in general, where there were only two prayers that were obligatory on the people in the beginning of Islam, and that later on, and they used to be two rak'ah only, and later on that was in the Al-Isra wal Mi'raj, you will see that was turned into five. Well, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he ordered Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that fasbir inna wa'adallahi haqq wa astaghfir li dhanbika wa sabbih bihamdi rabbika bil ashi wal ibkar. This is where it's extracted from, that the two prayers. The meaning of the ayah is, and glorify the praise of your Lord in Ashi wal Ibkar. Ashi means the time period after the mid noon till sunset, and Ibkar is the time period before from early morning or sunrise till before the mid noon. So that's how the beginning of the da'wah started. Now, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam was ordered to warn the people in the beginning. But in the beginning, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam's call was limited to the people who were close to him, his family members, the people from his tribe. But that did not mean the call was not known. The call was known among the people, but it was not directed towards the society. In the beginning, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was going towards the individuals, and his call was towards the individuals, and he was bringing those individuals into folds of Islam. And this is why we see that the beginning part of the call of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam towards Islam did not, you don't see that much of a confrontation from the kuffar at that time. But once this call became the call towards the society, then we see the different kinds of hardships that start coming towards Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the Sahaba. But in the beginning, it was about 3 years or so, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam's call was only geared towards the individuals. And you see that the da'wah in the beginning was going towards, like the ayah that revealed that says, Fandir Ashira al-Aqrabin, that you warn the people from your Ashira, and the Aqrabin, the one who are close to you. So for the Fandir, here the warning is towards them. And this is why when Abbas was talking to Afif, Abbas was aware of that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was a prophet and he was calling for a new deen, but they were not going after him to harm him in a way that you will see that later on they did. And this is one of the signs that how the Meccan society was. As we discussed when we were discussing the different religions that existed prior to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam became prophet, the Meccans did not really do much harm to those people, like that include Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam himself and Abu Bakr. Both of them, prior to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam became prophet, did not worship idols. They actually left idol worshipping. Same way, Zayd bin Nufail, the one who isolated himself from idol worshipping and used to sit next to the Kaaba and used to say things like, I don't worship any of these idols. I worship the Lord of Ibrahim, but I don't. I only believe in the Lord of Ibrahim, but I don't know how to worship him, because he did not have the wahi. He did not have the knowledge of how to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that knowledge comes from through the messengers. Same way, Waraq bin Nawfal, he was a Christian, and so these people did not do much in the beginning. But especially the ones who were strong, they did not go after him. Yes, you find some incidents of, for example, Bilal. But Bilal came to fold of Islam a little later. But most of the things that happened out of all this is when Rasulullah says the hardships and difficulties that the Sahaba Rasulullah came, they were facing, they started after Rasulullah his call became an open call towards all. And inshallah, we will talk about the open call from, we'll start from next week, inshallah, the open call. So I'll stop here if there is any questions or comments about the subject I covered today. Inshallah, I'll try to answer. Jazakumullah khair.